consume.
Of them to mold the society and to direct them in the proper direction. They have contributed in that way to society and the social reforms, political reforms and stability, education, empowerment, industrial revolution. The world has noticed, witnessed, and continuously been subjected to a series of various subjections from various corners and various faculties, totally aiming at a totalitarian or holistic development of a composite society. Likewise, in the spiritual hierarchy, or in the spiritual history also, the world has witnessed innumerable people. It has witnessed the innumerable people in the sense there are innumerable members of the society who are believers of God and they have their foundation of faith. Apart from faith, the world has seen a lot of people who have consolidated the faith and capable of experiencing the fruits of faith in means of ecstasy. We have also seen a lot of people who have got revelations and who have buried the revelations into silence, went to the deep solitude and silence and performed the penance and austerity and contributed everything by means of that invisible radiation that penetrated into society for the development of all around well-being. And we have also people who have recorded their revelations, who have inscribed each little imprint and impulse of their experience for the welfare of the future society and framed a system of lineage by means of which it can reach the society depending upon the mode of operation, need of operation, intensity of operation, and also it deals with the various levels of the recipients and receptivity. Catering to a contemporary society, changing society, adverse society, multiple society, pluralistic society, and a futuristic society, it needs different styles of the same rendering. And we cannot create a generalized way of a rendering which is suitable for every period. But they have created such a lineage which is multidimensional and super versatile, from which we can inspire whatever we want without any change for any period, for any person, any personality, for any particular application. That is known as standardization or all suitability, universal applicability and external relevance. So those people, those who have recorded, they are in a higher range. Those people who have elaborated, elucidated, illustrated, performed, institutionalized, visualized, conceptualized, innumerable divisions are there. The Shastra says that there are 64 persons of spiritual history, there are 64 different varieties. Some may register them as hierarchy, somebody says that they are all equal and it is a variety. According to one single point of view, they say that it is a hierarchy. A person who believes is in a very inceptive level, and a person who firmly establishes his belief in the second level. So believing, establishing the belief, empowerment of belief, experience of belief, imposition of the belief, recording of the belief, revelation of the belief, manifestation of the belief, disciplinic succession and initiation of the belief, then institutionalization in the form of a philosophical doctrine, way of life, mode of life, practices, observations, and various other things are there in the society. According to a single point of view, as per the traditional sciences, it is a way of hierarchy based on the impact, not on the eligibility, based on the impact of the society. For example, if somebody is buried in silence inside a cave, the person is not visibly contributing, he cannot be a source of inspiration. A person who jumps into the field of the society where there are abnormities, where there are cleavages and imbalances, such a person creates an inspiration in the society, role model in the society. More than a person's eligibility, his impact that he can create in the society is to be more valued. In that sense, sons and mahants, they are the people who jump into the society. There are three things. Persons, those who are superior, they have three dimensions. One is superiority, second is equality, third is inferiority. What is superiority of the superior people? Superiority of the superior people is their boundless knowledge, inimitable experience and ecstatic trance, bliss and transcendentality is their superiority. Still, with means of great compassionate embrace, they feel and also make others feel that they are equal with them and move with them, mingle with them, merge with them in the society. That type of amalgamation creates equality. They go to the sublime level of submission and subservience so that they will make us think that they are inferior so that they can be very easily accessible. So, superior people are those people, those who create sense of equality in the society by their merge and also come to the level of, it is known as Naityanusandhana. In Shastras, it is known as Naityanusandhana. A person who is superior in nature, becomes equal in activity, thinks inferior in the inner mind, he is the great soul, he is known as Mahan. Such a person is highly percolative, he can perpetuate his vibrations and his violent feelings and experience in society, creating a very great mega transformation of spiritual evolution in the society. So, according to spiritual variety of categorization or even hierarchy, we have three major schools of thought. One is a Rishi, second is a Siddha, and third is an Acharya. Rishi is the person who makes the plans for observing the fundamental primeval status of knowledge particles. So a person who creates the epistemological source or foundation of philosophy or a system is known as a Rishi. A person who self experiences whatever that has been promulgated and propagated or inbuilt or incorporated, the concrete message that is there, which is permeable, which is ubiquitous in the message that has been got, that a person is known as Siddha. So, Rishi grasps the source of knowledge and he configures everything, and a person who enjoys the knowledge and experiences by himself is known as a Siddha, and a person who shares with everybody, jumps to the level and sees that they are emancipated equally and excellently, such a person is Acharya. Now we are celebrating the glory of Acharya, because Rishis, they have created the seed. It has been irrigated and Siddha they have experienced, but the fruits are being given by the Acharyas only, which can possess also the seed by creating so many cyclic evolution of trees, thereby creating a grove, a forest, or a full greenery inhabitation of spiritual fertility that is possible only by Acharyas. So we want to think, we want to analyze whom we are worshipping, whom we are glorifying, how they are great, and what is the impact on each and every individual. So first of all, you are all individuals. Second thing, you are all collective members of the domestic society. Third thing is you are part and parcel of the composite society or a greater society. Fourth is you are a global citizen. Fifth is you are a creation of God. This pentecostal or pentadimensional thought that should be immediately developed inside the mind by understanding the evolution, by understanding the progress that we can develop, by imbibing the knowledge, by imbibing the inspiration. There are five things you can get from the Acharyas. One is the knowledge you can get, second is source of inspiration, either figure, figuration and formulae, and third thing is we can get their anukampa, mercy, fourth is we can get their embrace through their lineage of Acharyas, fifth thing is immediately you can get solace, like a creeper which can crawl and deeply embrace a strong structure for its sustenance and stability and solidarity. We can immediately feel the sense of solace, sense of peace, sense of security by embracing an Acharya, by touching his lotus feet and thinking the same thing, incessant things in the mind in each and every task and effort that you are taking, whether it may be simple, arduous, risky, rewarding or Herculean, whatever it may be. So we have to understand, first of all, what an Acharya can contribute to that. There are three levels of contribution. The source of knowledge is what we call Veda, but Vedas are having their own problems. What are the problems of Vedas? Number one is, it's metaphorical language, you cannot understand. And second thing is nomenclature, it gives different names to the same God. And third thing is ambiguity, which you cannot get anything at all. Obscurity, where the line is not clear. Abstruseness, where the sensation is totally beyond the reach of a normal person. And the sixth thing is arispatology or paribhasha, which can be understood by only person, those who are deeply roasted and toasted inside the spiritual tutelage and practice of the verbs, the various occasions and practices of the spiritual terminology and action methodology. Without having that experience, merely attending a seminar, formulating a symposium, getting into the way of a workshop is insufficient for spiritual experience. It may be for something else like insurance policies, economic policies, business development and commerce and trade fair. It is okay. It is not suitable for a spiritual journey or spiritual experience. So, Veda is having a problem of unreachability to common man. So, you cannot reach the Vedas, you cannot comprehend the Vedas, you cannot categorize the Vedas, and you can not easily fix the essence and juice of the Vedas. That's why the Vedanta, the second system, has come for the rescue. The Vedanta system, that is the Upanishads, they clarify what is the Brahman, absolute reality, who has been mentioned with different names. And second thing, what is the purpose of human life? Third thing, how to attain that purpose? So, the reach or the end, the purpose of human life, and the tools by which we can attain everything has been made explicit and easily accessible in the Vedanta. even in Vedanta, Upanishads, there are having a lot of problems. That is Anuvada, Puruvada, Vakya, Tathvati, Nirnaya, but those things that are to be discussed in a wider platform. But I want to put it in a nutshell. You want to understand the real meaning of the world. That is a very great difficulty that we are facing in Upanishadic interpretations. So there is a different science known as hermeneutics or exegesis. You cannot just interpret Vedas as if you are translating Shakespeare, Milton or Shelley. It needs a different type of application of understanding Shruti. What the Vedic notion of Pan is. Second is Linga. What are all the various evidential authorities being given? Vakya. What is the statement that here is bounded to emphasize? And Prakarana, what is the context in which it is being told? Sthana, in which place, which gravity of augmentation and accentuation it has been pronounced. And sixth is Samakya, name. By name we cannot understand anything in Vedas. There may be the name Indra, it may denote Vishnu. There may be the name Rudra, it may denote Vishnu. Swagunaihi, Vatsalya, Saushilya, Swamitva, Saulabhyadi Gunaihi, Sarvan, Bhaktanu, Rodayati, Iti Rudra. So there, according to the explanation, that the God makes every devotee cry with ecstatic joy because of his auspicious qualities, he is known as Rudra. So by merely naming Rudra, you cannot connect the person with the object Rudra, who is in casual nomenclature as Shiva. So you have to understand all of these things. The science is known as exegesis, is known as Mimamsa. So this is also a real problem. So what the great people they did it in such a manner. I used to give a very good simile for all of these things. The Shastra gives a very good analogy. The rice that you get in the form of paddy in the field, it is full of dust, husk, stones and unwanted things. You cannot directly consume it. Second thing, even if it comes to the shop where it's been sold, no doubt it will be purified, it will be assembled, it will be packed neatly, but still it necessarily to be processed. It is to be added with the flavor and spicy thing, and it should be given in a nourishable, palatable, delicious and sumptuous manner. That can be given only by your mother. So the Veda gives me paddy rice, which is there in the field. And Vedanta provides a sharp thing which is no doubt cleaned, very much polished, sophisticated and packed and provided. But the mother gives it in a cooked manner. She knows how to appetize you, and she knows also how to make this thing digest to you. She knows your taste, timing, tendency, temper, temperament, tenacity, and various other psychological qualities that she can feed that. So Acharyas, Veda is agricultural field rice, and Vedanta is the same rice which is packed and sold in shops. Acharya, they give it in the form of Siddhanta, like Dvaita Advaita, Advaita, Shuddha Advaita, Bhava Advaita, Vishishta Advaita, Dvaita, Achintya Veda Veda, Veda Veda, Advaita. All of these various schools of thought, they are well processed, made it very clear, made it more palatable by means of giving rationalistic, pluralistic, futuristic, intrinsic, nuancial thoughts and various other dimensional approaches are given in the form of prima facie and solution, suspicion and its correction, evaluations, rectifications, various other in-depths which make these things easily digestible to a common man and assimilable to a beginner of philosophy. That is the greatness of Siddhanta, and Acharyas are providers of Siddhanta. Siddhanta is clarity about Brahma. Siddhanta is clarity about world. It is clarity about our life and our interconnectivity, inter-reliability, inter-organizational behavior between the world, the soul and the supreme is one of Siddhanta. That's what they given. There is always an opposition in the society. Why to follow a particular path? All paths are equal. There is a type of pseudo-compromise that exists in the society. It is not good. Each and everybody, they have their own spiritual pattern. My own linguistic pattern makes me to be born in a language, to adapt a language, to understand a language, to acquaint a language, to appreciate a language, and to see that I can master a language and make it a confluent, torrential shower of vocabulary, contents and compromise. I can do anything else. It is a linguistic pattern. Food pattern is there, behavioral pattern is there, associative pattern is there. Like that, each and everybody has a spiritual pattern. They have to select something from the available patterns because everything is based on our own configurative identity. That's why they say in Shastras that dharma jignasitavya athavo dharma jignasa. Dharma you cannot select by option, you cannot select by fascination. You must undergo an inner trial by which you can understand something about your real configurative status and see that whichever that is suitable from that level, you have to immediately observe it. So a person taking a system, he gets a grip In a ladder, he stands on a step, he gets a stage authenticity and authorization. A person without the system, he is a spiritual orphan, he cannot get any spiritual hold at all. He can get only interim relief and temporary, self-sophisticated, self-imagined success or solace or peace or comfort. He cannot get the grant of God. He can get only his speculative consequences. That's what Shastra has been saying. So you should follow your path, whatever it may be. Even if you are an atheistic, follow that as a system. What is a system? That which has a foundation, that which has an explanation, that which has a dimensional analysis, that which has all questions and answers, all suspicions and clarifications, all primary phases of solutions, with multi-dimensional approach which can suit for any trend, that is what is a system. A system is a compound that has all essential compounds for, number one, conviction. Self-conviction. Second thing, propagation. Third thing is establishment. So you can believe that and get convinced. You can also convince your opponent. You can establish in the society all the provisions that are provided for doing these three things that give all components united to form a compound which is known as a system, sampradaya, which we call in Sanskrit. So here we have to follow something. And we can do innumerable systems other than following also. You can select a system. Number one, we are having innumerable swatantriya. First is known as selection. I can select a system of my own. And second thing is I can go for deep studies. And I can firmly establish the system in my mind. I have already told you can establish it in others also. There are innumerable things. If somebody creates a doubt, answering that is known as nirdharana. If somebody asks for a proof, proving that is known as nirupana. If somebody is asking some sort of intricacies which are not easily answerable, making the person to relish and realize is known as prachodana and shodana. Nidarshana is self-practice by which we can prove those things in the society. Samsthapana is when your religion, when your system is in danger, when it is about to vanish, to resurrect and reinstall the same thing is known as resurrection. It is a system of resurrection. That is known as samsthapana. Already existing, established thing is re-established. So a spiritual person should have the gadgets of nirdharana, nishkarsha, nirupana, pramanikarana, bodhana, avabodhana, pradarshana, nidarshana, sandarshana, margadarshana. All of these various tools, spiritual gadgets are essential for an acharya. It is not an easy job. So we have to take a particular system of this thing in life. And how to take a system? The only solution is hagiology. What is hagiology? It is the study of saints. It is a study of divine people and their lives. It deals with three things. One is their biography, in which their biodata is there. And second thing is their ontodata, spiritual data is there. Metadata is about their experience. Megadata is about their achievements. Innumerable things are there. I think that I have been invited for a valedictory address, not for some other research paper. So I cannot go beyond that. So innumerable data are there. Where he was born, historical data. There is a lot of problem between, always there will be a battle between theologians and historians. Imbarga is told to be born in 11th century. But spiritual archaeology, religious theology, that says that he is born before Christ. The Yuganta, even in Shankaracharya, there are innumerable things that is subjected to discussion later. So, life, for whom he is born, whose incarnation he is, when he has realized his incarnative nature, who has realized his incarnation nature, who is the revealer, who is the Bodhaka teacher for the person, who are all the associates who are there at the time of his realization, what is the first initial output of his realization, is it a word, is it a miracle? There are three things in hagiology. One is compassion, second is radiation, third thing is erudition. Erudition is the knowledge exposition of a master. That is known as epistemology. Second thing is compassion, how he moves with the society, ontopsychology. Third thing is radiation, how he is powerful, how he can be what we call preternatural and supernal or transcendental, how he has proved that he is beyond nature. He can control natural forces like gravity and magnetism, fire and water, everything can be kept under control of a demand, command, order and subjection. How he can bring subservience? So that is known as thaumatology. Each and every hagiology, the life that proves that the person is beyond nature, not only in performance but also in knowledge, but also extraordinarily compassionate and altruistic in nature for the society. So hagiology gives various things. And from hagiology, there are four beneficiaries. One is elementary beneficiary. Second is enthusiastic beneficiary. Third thing is elite beneficiary. Fourth thing is ecstatic beneficiary. So even if it is a great soul, he has made provisions for all people. Then only he is to be great. A great person is really great when he thinks about the non-great people, that they should also become equally great. A person who thinks that he is great and meant for only great, the person is an inferior person, and the person's inferiority female inferiority. Catching the feeling to say that. So, these people, like Limbarga Acharya, they have made provisions for elementary people to enter inside with the same courage, with the same hope that a very great elite person in Vedas and Vedanta can enter inside. That is the greatness of this teacher. For elite knowledge oriented people also, they have made provisions. And third thing is, for great people who are there in ecstatic divine experience, they are given room. And even a person with mere enthusiasm, they are given a lot of other things. So according to philosophy and contribution to Goel thought, it is about the sophisticated elite propitiation possibility of Limbarga's philosophy on Goel thought. What do you mean by Goel thought? What do you mean by Goel thought? First we have to explain that it is not about the origination of the world, which is known as cosmology and cosmogony. It is not about the world's evolution with the special standards like anthropology, whether it is cultural or social. World thought is to think about the world. Here world is representative or delegative. Here world mentions the worldly living beings. So world thought deals with a particular dimension approach of thought where we think about, number one, to understand the creator as well as the sustainer of this world for getting us the benefit of his compassionate shower by which we can be empowered to embrace the people who are dependent on us, our followers, the downtrodden, the deplorable, the despicable, totally abandoned members of the society. Utilizing God's power, God's grace, mercy and knowledge tools for empowering the downtrodden community to give them not only physical comfort but spiritual bliss and a social survival and standardity is known as world thought. World thought is a study of philosophy whereby we can understand, one, how to tame our mind and control ourselves, how to sharpen our intellect and realize what is good to us. So many things are immediately good, but at the end they are sorrowful stories. So some of the things are appearing to be pseudo-arrivic in nature, but in future they are resulting in untold miseries of the society. So to evaluate, to create a touchstone for ethical precision and ethical evaluation, number one, how to boost the intellect, how to bind relations between the members of the society who are in various cleavages, and how to create harmony in the society. Fourth thing, how to fraternize the society, how to propitiate or satisfy the God who has purposefully created you, and how to reach his abode. These five dimensions are the world thoughts. Thinking about the world, about world trade, world economics, geopolitical studies, geoeconomical studies, war suppression, conflict resolution, various other studies are there. World thought of Limbarga Acharya, it is not thinking about the stem or branch, but thinking about the root of philosophy. What is the root of philosophy? Mind taming, intellectual sharpening, disharmony to be eradicated, and harmony to be installed among relations, relations to be made more productive and precise, and to result in the end of human life is knowing God, serving his people, attaining his abode, or coming back even to serve more to the people. All of these things are the root of emancipation. This is what we call world thought. And to brief in the concluding address, I want to say some of the things in Vaishnavism, common Vaishnavism, and the philosophical studies of teleology, axiology, epistemology, metaphysics, agrathology, and various other things about the Brahman. Brahman study about Brahman is ontology. Axiology is study of the composite study of elements, their nature, connectivity, and impact. Teleology is the study of the purpose. Without purpose, nothing will exist. There should be a purpose. What you are thinking as a purpose is actually different. That is a book. There are three purposes of a book. Using a book as a pillow is known as Kshudra Prayojana. Using the book as a tool of beauty or pride to carry it to school, that is also Alpa Prayojana. Reading the book without or with understanding it is known as Prayojana. And publishing book, annotating books, teaching about the books, and publishing the matter by means of oral, verbal, written, annotative commentaries, all of things known as Paraprayojana. We can reach a lot of people. To achieve whatever that has been provided in the knowledge shore and shower is known as Paramaprayojana. So we also have Prayojana in life. To marry, to beget children, to enjoy the life by means of proper position evaluation and multi-progress level status, dual income, multiple income, secret income, auditable income, innumerable things are there in life. So these things are Prayojana. Whatever we get through ethical means, that is a Prayojana. Whenever you make others to get the same thing, or at least don't disturb while they are getting their own needed things which are counted ethically for them. If you don't interrupt and intrude in others' life, that itself is a very great pravina, para pravina. But to end the life of misery and to understand the God, that's why the Shastra say that the earth, you know that it is very heavy. Can you carry a bag of rice for 2 or 3 hours together? No. Even the rice carrier, he cannot carry beyond that limitation. So, which is the burden for the earth? The burden for the earth, there are two burdens. One is composite elemental burden, and second is molecular burden. Molecular burden is the sagara portion, and elemental burden is the parvata, the mountain. But they are not the real burdens of the society. Those who are not thinking of God and praying in gratitude and behaving in such a manner so that he is displeased, such a person is burden to the earth. Lakinchit parvata bharam, nabharam satta sagaram, swamitroham idam bharam, bharam vishwasa ghatanam. So we want to understand that we should not be a burden to creation, but we should be a boon in creation. We should not be an asset in creation, we should be an asset to the creation. We should not be perfunctory in creation, we should be productive in creation. We should not be prevaricated in the creation, but we should be possessive and focused in the creation, forgetting the teleology. That is the greatness. So the birth of Nimbarka's contribution is, the final thing we should be decided in this conference is, he has created such a system by which to induce gratitude towards God and to please him by his equal behavior of divine precision, catering to the need of the development of the modern society, from which scientific development, technical development, social empowerment, gender discrimination, women empowerment, child care, malnutrition, agitation, all of these things are the byproducts. So if there is a gajabhojana in which a big morsel of food is taken by an elephant, there are two things, ant and elephant. Whenever an elephant consumes something, the scattered morsels are more than enough for a feast for thousands of ants. So whenever a person propitiates the soul and makes the foundation very firm and also permeable in the society, all the, I have already told, economy, political, social, scientific, technical, everything is like the scattered pieces meant for the ants. So elephant's morsel is spiritual sturdity, and ants feed that are very scattered pieces. So he has made the major feed for the soul by spiritual solidarity. That is very great. According to the science of Nimbarka, whenever there are, we used to say, there are Sodara Vaishnavas. That's why with very great difficulty and very staunchness I address this, because I very much see, whenever you are having lot of brothers in various districts, you will be interested in meeting them. Everybody is a brother, but there is a distant brother, drastic brother, and divisional brother. Those who are having philosophical proximity, like Advaita, Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya is the number one Vaishnava. And this Shivananda Gari, Soundarya Gari has nothing to do with Adi Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya is as staunch as Ramanujacharya was there in Narayana philosophy. The only problem is, he accepted Narayana as a Ishvara and considered Brahman as a Nirvishesha. There are two status. In the absolute status, Brahman is Nirvishesha, it is not Vishnu or Narayana. But by an upadhi manas avidya, by an illusory cover, there is created an illusory world in which there are different forms. In that Sabhishesha form, Narayana is the supreme. So there is the first brother. Second thing is Dvaita of Madhvacharya. Third thing is Shuddhadvaita of Vallabhacharya. Fourth thing is Dvaita Dvaita of Nimbarkacharya. Second is the same Vishishta Dvaita followed by Ramanandacharya as well as Swaminarayanacharya and Shankaradeva's Sarvajiva Uddharnavada. Innumerable systems of philosophy are there in which these 7 schools of thought, they have proximity. They are all close brothers, cousin brothers, and colonial brothers. 3 levels of brothers, I want to say. These 7 people, they are all close brothers. And second thing is, we are also having innumerable people like Shaivas, Pashupatas, Shaktas, they are also our brothers. They belong to the same Vedic tradition, they are known as cousin brothers. And even atheists, communists, and innumerable systems are there in this world where they proclaim that they want to create a socialistic republic, an equalistic republic, a proletariat republic, whatever it may be, they are also our brothers, provided if they are realistic in nature and pragmatically in real practice, if the real intention is to serve the society at all. So these are all the brothers. So this forms the first circle of brotherhood. They say that Brahman is having 4 forms. One is Brahma Rupa, that is absolute. Second is Ishvara, who participates in the world affairs. So one who is official and absolute. The third thing is Jiva Rupi Brahma. Fourth is Jagatrupi Brahma. This is the philosophy of Nimbarkacharya. So Nimbarkacharya says that God can be absolute and God can be official. God can be immanent inside you and he can be ubiquitous in universal impact. He can be inside the world, that is not ubiquitous. He can be inside you, that is immanent. He can be absolute and he can be also official in nature, dealing with creation, sustenance and destruction. The impact of this thing should be discussed later. That is his idea. Regarding Jiva also, very great philosophical intricacies to be read. Samya, Ati Samya, Atyanta Samya, Dhuva, Ati Dhuva, Atyanta Dhuva. Where they are very proximate and very, very proximate. Distant, very, very distant. These are the qualities to be read. And according to them, according to Nimbarka's school of thought, God is both Nirguna and Sarguna. Auspicious qualities are there and God can be colorless and qualityless in one status. You should understand one basic principle. Considering God as a single person or a personality is one school of thought. Second school of thought is Mithuna school of thought, like Radha Krishna, Lakshmi Narayana. So many people they asked, it must be a human imagination, why God should possess concert and other things. It is like just like a domestic life of a mortal. Why it is like that? It is not like that. It is a personification. There is a Shakti known as Akladini and Anukampani. So the mercy of God and the bliss of God has a proper substitution in the form of a delegated authority known as Shri Shakti or Stri Shakti. So a person should get, see, just as lifting a very big rock by using a crane. A person who is totally inauspicious and a bulk of blunders and sins and aberrations, he cannot directly approach God. He needs purushakara or recommendation or propitiation of the God and the enthronement of their relation by means of a proper middle service. Acharya is like that, Sri Tattva is like that, Radha Tattva is like that. So innumerable things are there. Bhakti is the sadhana. What is bhakti? We are not bhaktas. There are three people in bhaktas. Bhakta, Ichukas, Prayatamana. Prayatamana is one who is trying to become a bhakta. And Ichuka is one who is loving to be a bhakta. Bhakta is a real bhakta. And other people are those who are thinking that they are bhaktas, those who are thinking that they are the only bhaktas, they are all excluded in this calculation. So, that is bhakti, bhaja, sevaya. Unconditional service to God by true sense is known as bhakti. How it can happen? By shastras, by association with people. Just as there are infectious diseases, if you move with a real devotee, you will get the positive infection of the same status and grade or gravity of devotion. And mukti is oneness with God. It is oneness in feeling, not merging of water with water as per Nimbarka school. And as a final statement, what is the purpose of this seminar and impact in the society? One is Vishwa Vaishnavam. We have to create a system of Vishwa Vaishnavam wherein by all Vaishnava trends. So the Veda says in Shatapatha Brahmana, Purusha Vaishnava, so there is the Veda two times. All people, as God is immanent inside, there are Vaishnavas. So there are only two people, not Vaishnavas and Avaishnavas. Realized Vaishnavas and people, those who don't know the real address. So there are two Vaishnavas. So to create a Vishwa Vaishnava system. Second is to create the modern tools. You see, Nimbarkacharya is not known by everybody. They know the cinema actors, political people, fictional agents like Superman is known to everybody. By means of media reach, we should apply the tools of web designing, web implementation, cyberspace discussion, EduSat, info system of learning by means of various other e-learning systems to be made. 2 minutes, then you can do anything. Using all the modern tools for propagation. If people are modern, if you want to create the orthodoxy or the original system, eternal system to penetrate inside that, you should adopt the tool of number one. PowerPoint presentation should be there. The people, they have lost the patience of hearing from acharyas. They are attuned to gaze the Mukhamandala of acharya. There are innumerable padmas. Mukhamandala of the acharya should be seen. The Netra Padma of the Acharya should be imbibed. The Karapadma of the Acharya should be pointed at you. The Padapadma of the Acharya should be embraced by you. No Padma is there available in the society. They are totally made in monotonous. They are not ready to be, even if they are ready, the physical system is not ready. They cannot sit in a proper position like that. They will be moving, rounding here and there, stretching, leaning, incumbent in all shapes of God which we can see in temples. We can see all the shapes in the people working in offices and reading in schools. They will do like this, like Ranganatha, they will do like this. They will be continuously moving their physical positions because of lack of ergonomic as well as ergonomic understandings. They are doing like that. So, we used to modern tools which are there meant for the same propagation of other things in the society, number two. Third thing is how to utilize these philosophies to create ethical impulse or ethical awareness in the society. For how to make this belief to get empowerment, hope, confidence. Yes, I can study, I can work, I can be honest, I can be dedicated to my nation, I can be obedient to my parents. How to convert this philosophy, that is the problem. Those who are ethical, they are having the problem of blindness so that they cannot see the philosophical light. Those who are having the philosophy, they cannot mobilize themselves into the society, they are lame. By a blind, lame mutuality or joint venture, the flaws that exist with both the systems, they should be reconciled, and we should see that the mobilizability of philosophy is induced and approachability of the common ethics is made towards that philosophy. It is the purpose of seminars like that. So we should see what is the social approach of this, what is the spiritual approach of this, and how it can be utilized to develop patriotism, ethicism and pluralistic survival in the society. They should identify who is the real Acharya. Acharya is a very great person. We cannot get Acharyas, but we can get three things. One, a place inside our heart for Acharya. Second, to get a person who is in the lineage of Acharya, to behave in such a manner that the Acharya wishes to see you visibly or invisibly. He can give his stone or oracle. He can appear before you or in his dreams, whatever it may be. So we should behave so that we are all Acharya associates, to be associated with Acharyas, and to find a place for Acharyas inside our heart. That should be the real purpose of life. And these three things are very much essential, and that is the quintessence of today's lecture. And persons who are teaching yoga, they are also Acharyas. They are Amukhya Acharyas. They are not prominent Acharyas. Acharya is a person who can give to you the spiritual address. I told something about an Acharya, I want to say it and finish one. Who is an Acharya? God is adamant. So that he is not very much responding on you because of your sins. You are adamant because of your ignorance. So a person who can either grasp your hand and take you to the God, or grasp the hands of the God and bring him to you, such an efficacious person, such an eminent person is known as Acharya. He should either take you there or bring him here. Such a very great efficacy is the power of Acharya. Yogacharya is a yoga teacher. Now Acharya means they say about only Yogacharya, a person who is doing Vastu, a person seeing astrology. So no doubt there is spiritual belief in the society, there is not a right belief, a right rate of belief. I want people to get the awareness of realizing real Acharyas, who are all the soul savers and saviors of our future, and submit ourselves to them and get the eternal bliss, as well as to contribute to the social progress as a whole. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.